إن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد. We are in the time around the Christmas season, which is a time where Christians celebrate the birth of Jesus, who, according to their beliefs, is like the second Adam. They call him the second Adam because Adam sinned and caused all his descendants to inherit his guilt. They call this original sin. And so they say that Isa alayhi salam, Jesus came to eradicate that original sin through his sacrifice on the cross. Now, it's important for Muslims to be informed on this subject, specifically Muslims living in a Christian majority. So this seems like an appropriate time for us to talk about this. The first difference that we have with regards to this biblical narrative, with regards to the origin story or the Genesis story, is that we don't believe that life is a punishment. We believe that life is a test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the angels, "Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa," that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before even creating Adam alayhi salam, He told the angels, "I'm going to put a khalifa on the earth." Now, that means he knew that Adam alayhi salam was going to start in Jannah, make a mistake, and then get put onto earth. So the question then comes, if this was the intention from the beginning, and if Allah even stated to the angels that this is what's going to happen, he's going to get to the earth, the question is, why put him in Jannah to begin with? The idea is, life is a test. And in order to start that test properly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first put him in Jannah, allowed him to understand the consequences of a mistake, so that he can feel guilty, so that he can understand that sinning has very negative consequences. It gets you, basically, to lose out on Jannah. It is a very big thing. And so now that you have understood what the consequences of sin are, now you can start your test. Now you are equipped to begin this test called life. Because so now you know the difference between doing right and doing wrong, because wrong earns you problems, puts you in a bad situation, and so forth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained, furthermore, the parameters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Adam alayhi salam and Hawa what? قُلْنَا اِهْبِطُوا مِنْهَا جَمِيعًا فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي هُدًى فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the parameters of this test very clearly. Allah told Adam alayhi salam and his wife Hawa and even Iblis, what all of you get down, all of you go to earth, and when guidance comes to you from me, whoever follows my guidance, there will be no fear concerning them, and nor will they grieve. And those who disbelieve and deny our signs, they will be the companions of the fire, and they will abide therein eternally. What is the idea here? That A, life is a test, and B, the parameters are very clearly defined. Follow guidance, you're good. Disbelieve, deny, turn your back on guidance, and you are going to be punished for it. So the parameters are very clear. The biblical version, however, it seems that life is a punishment. After Adam alayhi salam made his mistake, ate from the tree, what happened? God speaks to Adam and says to Adam, he said, "Because you listened to your wife and ate fruit from the tree about which I command you, you must not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you will return." This is in Genesis 3, from 16, 17, 18, 19, around there. What is being said here? I put you in paradise, you made a mistake, because of that mistake you're going to be punished with earth. There's no mention of repentance. There's no mention of resurrection. There's no mention of going back into paradise. So basically there's a big difference between life being a test and life basically being a punishment. Yes, there is no emphasis from the biblical perspective on repentance. As opposed to the Quran, Allah says, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ, that indeed Adam received from his Lord some words, as in words of repentance, and Allah accepted his repentance. And those words are even defined in the Quran. Allah says what those words are. قَالَ رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. They said, as in Adam and Hawa, Eve, they both said, Our Lord, we have wronged ourselves, and if you do not forgive us and have mercy upon us, we will surely be amongst the losers. So clearly, mistake, test, repentance, and then forgiveness, insha'Allah ta'ala. Allah says He accepted His repentance, and that's why Adam alayhi salam is an example. He's a prophet, and we believe that he is in Jannah. However, the Bible has no emphasis on repentance. In fact, it just says Adam lived out his sentencing and then died. Altogether, Adam lived a total of 930 years and then he died, Genesis 5:5. So this leaves us with a whole slew of questions, specifically about this original sin idea. Number one, if Adam was made in God's image and he wasn't created with original sin, the whole idea is that we have inherited original sin, but he wasn't created with it. So if he was created in God's image and he did not have original sin, why did he sin? Why did he eat from the fruit? If it was intentional, then it seems that he did have some sort of original sin. And if it was an accident, then why would he be guilty? That's question number one. Number two, did Adam repent? If the answer is yes, why wasn't it mentioned in the Bible? Shouldn't there be some emphasis there? And number two also, if yes, why did we inherit original sin but not inherit original repentance? Doesn't it seem that if Adam repented for his mistake, that we shouldn't just inherit his original sin but also his original repentance? But no, there's no mention of that. And if the answer is no, if Adam alayhi salam, they believe, made this mistake, lived on earth, and then died on earth, and he never felt remorseful, then why do Christians name their children Adam? Really, this is basically a person who caused every single human being to be out of paradise. And he never felt bad for it once. Completely unremorseful, unrepentful. So then why do you consider him an example and name your children Adam? It seems very confusing. It seems rather that he's on level or on par in terms of evil with perhaps even the devil himself. So why would you name your children Adam? So if yes, there's a problem. If no, there's a problem with regards to the issue of repentance. Number three. If God warned Adam about the fruit, saying, "For when you eat from it, you will certainly die." So this is the threat. You eat from that fruit and you will die. Then what happened after his death? So he was told, "You will die if you eat from this fruit." Yes, so then he was sent to earth, he lived, and then he died. So A, was he given a second sentencing? As in, was he, in addition to the punishment of earth, sent to hell after that to burn for eternity? Seems like the punishment was defined as life on earth and then death. So then why would you give him a second sentencing to hell? Or is it that he just simply ceased to exist? No mention of the afterlife, no mention of resurrection, he just died. Almost from an atheistic perspective. You live, you turn to dust, nothing else. Or thirdly, is it that, which would seem logical, that he lived out his sentence, he completed his sentencing, and therefore he was returned to heaven? And that would seem to make sense, that the wages of sin are death, he was sent to earth, he died, and therefore the punishment is over, go back to heaven. But if that's the case, which seems the most logical, if that is the case, where's the need for Jesus to take the punishment of death onto all of us? Take all of our deaths onto himself? It seems odd. It seems like it doesn't make sense. Why is there this claim that you need this sacrifice, this divine sacrifice, Jesus to come to be killed in order to take away the sentencing when everybody fulfills their sentencing, even Christians? They accept Jesus and then they say, that, well, obviously they go through their lives and they die. So if the wages of sin are death, and you are a Christian and you live out your life and then you die, where is the, you've fulfilled your sentence, it's done. Where is the need for this extra concept of Jesus erasing your original sin? Number four, if Adam, alayhi salam, caused original sin, which we don't believe in, but this is what they say. If Adam, alayhi salam, caused this original sin to be inherited by his offspring, why wasn't it mentioned anywhere in the Old Testament? Furthermore, why is the opposite mentioned in the Old Testament? We find that the concept of self-accountability is very much a theme in the Old Testament. It says, for example, the son shall not suffer the iniquity of the father, nor the father suffer the iniquity of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon himself, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon himself. So it seems very much that the biblical narration is saying what? Self-accountability. You're responsible for what you do. Some people might say, yeah, but that's the Old Testament. Yeah, but nothing is older than Adam alayhi salam, right? If it was true from Adam's time, then that's the beginning of our story, of the human story. So why would you then say, oh, well, I don't accept the Old Testament narration when this took place and was supposed to be established from as early as human history begins? So that argument doesn't work. And even if you do want to stick to that answer and say, no, no, as Christians sometimes do, that I don't take from the Old Testament, I only believe in the New Testament. Well, guess what? The New Testament also has a verse that describes self-accountability. It says in Galatians 6:5, for every man shall bear his own burden. Every man shall bear his own burden. So therefore, this is against the concept of original sin. This is now in the Old Testament, the New Testament, and what we believe to be the Final Testament, the Quran. Five times in the Quran, Allah says what? La taziru waziratun wizra ukhra. Allah mentions in Surah An'am, Surah Isra, Surah Fatir, Surah Zumar, and in Surah Najm. Five times in the Quran, Allah says that no bearer of burdens will bear the burden of another. In other words, you're responsible for your own sins and your own actions, all your own deeds. In addition to it being from the Old Testament, from the New Testament, and from the Quran, it's just common sense. It's just common sense. What is your definition of a sin? A sin is what? When you do something wrong, right? So how can you inherit it from somebody else who you never met, you never talked to, you never approved of what they did, you never saw them do it, you have nothing to do with it, and that you inherit that sin? Then what is your definition of sin? It doesn't seem to make sense. Guilt is when you choose to do something wrong, not when somebody else has done it. And subhanAllah, in Islam, this deen is so beautiful that even if you have the intention to do something wrong, we know that the Prophet ﷺ teaches us that if you have the intent to do something wrong and then you resist it, you actually get ajr. You get reward for that because you had the temptation of evil and you overcame it. So this is very different. Point number five, we should ask our Christian friends and neighbors and coworkers and classmates, when you see a baby, do you see innocence or do you see guilt worthy of punishment? And this to me, subhanAllah, I don't understand. I don't understand how anybody can look at a baby and think, yep, guilty needs to be punished, whether it be in jail or in hell or some kind of punishment. SubhanAllah, this is completely 100% against the fitrah, against our natural inclination. When you see a baby, naturally, every human being sees what? Innocence. And so if seeing innocence in a child is a fundamental reality, and if your religion contradicts that fundamental reality, the question is, what do you drop? Do you drop reality or do you drop the religion? This is the question. And there's a beautiful quote from a famous philosopher, Muslim philosopher named Ismail al-Faruqi. He said it very beautifully when he said, to ignore reality is to be ignored by reality. To ignore reality is to be ignored by reality. In other words, if somebody pitches a religion and says, my beliefs say that, you know, a bunch of different ideas that go completely against reality. We don't drop the reality, we drop your religion. That's simply more reasonable. And if that's not enough, if the person says, no, I don't care of what my inclination teaches me, I don't care what ideas may be, what I naturally incline towards, rather, I'm just going to believe in it. Why? Because this is the belief of the New Testament. Well, then my answer is actually no. It seems very much the case that Jesus confirmed the innocence of children, going against the idea of original sin when Jesus said, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. This is in Matthew 19:14. So he's very clearly saying that these innocent children, let them come to me because these are the types of people in heaven. It seems that he's saying they're innocent, they're children, and that's who goes to heaven, the innocent. Wallahu a'lam, how do you deal with this quote? Why would you go against what seems to be the Old Testament perspective, the New Testament perspective, common sense, the Quranic perspective, to believe in people like, let's say, Saint Augustine, who said, do not believe, nor say, nor teach that infants who die before baptism can obtain the remission of original sin. Basically saying, look, babies go to hell. SubhanAllah al-Azim. What an unbelievable perspective to hold. Point number seven. Why is it the case that Isa alayhi salam, if the Christian believes that Isa alayhi salam was sent, his entire mission was to eradicate this concept of original sin, we need to ask the Christians, why did he never describe it explicitly? Why did he never describe that every single human being is born completely guilty and I am here to remove all that? Why not outline your mission? It seems to be a problem. And furthermore, they believe that Isa alayhi salam was sacrificed and that's what removed the original sin. First and foremost, we don't believe that he was sacrificed. We don't believe that he was put on the cross. Allah says, وَمَا قَتَلُهُ وَمَا صَلَبُهُ, that they did not kill him and they did not crucify him. And even in Hebrews 5:7, it says that Jesus, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. That means Jesus, in the Bible, it says that Isa was the one praying to God to save him, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. He was heard because of his reverent submission. It says in the New Testament, what? That because he was so sincere in begging, save me from death, save me from death, God heard his prayer because of how sincere he was. Heard his prayer means what? Heard it and rejected it? It seems that because it's describing his sincerity, it's saying what? He heard his prayer and accepted it and did save him. So from a Quranic perspective, it seems that Isa alayhi salam was saved. This verse of the Bible also gives question to the idea that he was, it makes it questionable. Why was he begging for a savior to be saved and he wasn't? It seems rather that he was, according to this verse. But let's leave that aside for a second, and let's even just accept the idea. Okay, fine, you say that he was sacrificed. What did it accomplish? This is our question that we will answer in the second khutbah, inshallah. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam salim kathira. Bismillah, bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. So the question is, what did it accomplish, this human or divine sacrifice, if you will, from the Christian perspective, what did it accomplish? Did it undo original sin from their perspective? If so, why is it that the atonement, the forgiveness, is only applicable to a person who both has knowledge of it and acceptance of the sacrifice when we don't have to have knowledge or acceptance of the sin of Adam? Do you guys see the double standard here? It seems that you're born, you don't know about what happened with Adam, you never approved of it, you had no knowledge of it, and they believe that you inherit that sin anyway. And now there's a sacrifice 2,000 years ago that's supposed to wash away that sin. Okay, good, so that means I'm clean. No, 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 you have to know of it and accept it. Wait a second, I didn't know or accept of the first one, so why the double standard? That in and of itself is a problem. So did it eliminate original sin, yes or no? Number two, it seems, the question is, did this sacrifice of Jesus kill Satan? In Romans 16:20, it seems that yes, it says that Jesus crushed the head of Satan, and therefore it seems that Satan is dead. But Christians also believe that Satan is very much alive. So did it delete original sin? Yes or no? Did it kill Satan? Yes or no? And finally, did it eradicate evil works? In 1 John 3:7-8, it seems that yes, because of the sacrifice of Jesus, evil works were eradicated. But at the same time, we look around the world and we see there's still war, there's still murder, there's still theft, there's still plenty of evil. So did it eradicate evil? Yes or no? I've heard one answer, Christians say, well, what it did was it allowed the believers, it allowed the Christians to overcome and resist temptation. But again, I said my response to this is, people were overcoming temptation before the sacrifice of Isa alayhi salam. Your claim that he was sacrificed. Prior to this, the Old Testament describes Job resisting temptation, describes Joseph, Yusuf alayhi salam. It's the same story almost, I mean, there's similarities. In the Quran, you know, the Aziz's wife, the wife she of his master, you know, says, come lie with me. And he says, no, he resists temptation. So people were resisting temptation. So again, the question is, what did it accomplish? It seems like there's a lot of confusion. Now, why do I bring all these various questions up? I know that most people, most Christians, that is, don't think about what they're celebrating. Honestly, they don't think about it. They just exchange gifts, put up decorations, not realizing that those decorations, you know, lighting of the trees and so forth, traces back to pagan celebrations of the winter solstice festivals, which was blended with Christianity. They're not aware of this. A lot of them don't pay attention to this fact. Nor do they realize that Saint Nicholas, you know, Santa Claus, actually traces back to a Turkish man. Turk, can you imagine? Subhanallah. The original Saint Nicholas was Turkish. I just thought that's fat. Every time you go in the store and you see these pictures, just think, you know, Middle East, Turkish, subhanAllah. Most of them don't think about these things. They don't think about this, they just want to exchange gifts. But that's our job. Our job is to make people trace it all back. To say, let's go back before Saint Nicholas. Let's go back all the way to the time of Isa alayhi salam. Let's go back even to the time of Adam alayhi salam. What are you celebrating? The birth of Jesus. Why? Because he eradicated sin. What sin? The sin of original sin that was introduced by Adam. Let's analyze that. Let's analyze what you are celebrating. Yes, we also believe in sacrifice. That's why we have Eid al-Adha, where we sacrifice. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clarifies that it's not about the sacrifice, it's about your piety. Allah says, لَنْ يَنَالَ اللَّهُ لُحُومُهَا وَلَا دِمَاؤُهَا وَلَكِنْ يَنَالُهُ التَّقْوَى مِنْكُمْ. That their meat will not reach Allah, nor will their blood, but what reaches him is your piety. In other words, when you sacrifice an animal and give that meat as charity. It's not the meat that reaches Allah, it's not the blood that reaches Allah, or the money that you spent in charity, it's not the money that reaches Allah. What is it? It's the taqwa. It's the piety. It's the God consciousness in your heart. And so Allah is saying, look, this idea of sacrificing in order to atone for sins, it's not about the sacrifice. It's about how you transform as an individual. And this is, by the way, confirmed by both the New Testament and the Old Testament. In the New Testament, Jesus talks about the Old Testament and says, but go and learn what this means. I desire, he's quoting God, I desire mercy and not sacrifice. I desire mercy and not sacrifice. For I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. So he's saying, look, it's not about sacrifice, it's about repenting. It's not about blood. It's about what? Transforming your heart and becoming a good person. And that is truly remarkable. From if the Christian is saying, no, everything depends upon the sacrifice of Jesus, while he himself is saying, look at the Old Testament, I'm telling you here in the New Testament, it's not about sacrifice, it's about repenting. It's about turning back to God. It's about transforming and being a better person. That's what this is all about, subhanAllah. This is what the Quran says, and this is what it seems the Old Testament and the New Testament are confirming. So nobody, we believe, nobody goes to hell because they were born. A'udhu billah. A'udhu billah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not oppress innocent children like this. Nobody goes to hell because they were born. And as Muslims in this country, it's very easy for us to get together in the masjid and amongst ourselves talk about these points, but that's not the objective. To sort of pat ourselves on the back and say, alhamdulillah, we're guided, and you know, oh, they're misguided. That's not the objective. The objective, rather, is to offer questions that we can think about, and then we could go to our friends, to our neighbors, to our classmates, to our co-workers. We can talk to the people and ask questions. Cause people to think. The Qur'an is full of questions. The Qur'an is a book of questions, subhanAllah. You go through the Qur'an, every page you're finding Allah is causing you to think by asking you different questions. And then when you go more specifically, look at the da'wah of the prophets. When you look at Nuh alayhi salam and what he said to disbelievers. What Ibrahim alayhi salam, what Musa alayhi salam said to their people. Questioning, always asking questions. This is an integral part of their da'wah. This is a crucial part of how they introduce people to Islam. Why? Because when you ask questions, you're not forcing your ideas on others. You're causing them to seek out the truth in their own way. You're just prompting them to do what? To arrive at the truth on their own terms. Let their own mind work out the problem. So the objective here is not to ridicule. The objective here is not to try to poke fun or to have these gotcha moments. The objective is what? To ask questions, to make people think, and inshallah, those who are sincere will appreciate it and realize that there's something wrong here. And we know that this is the time of year for the rest of this country, this is the time of the year that people exchange gifts, right? That's often the theme. Well then, what better gift than asking thought-provoking questions which will encourage somebody to actually pick up their Bible and analyze it? Or hopefully even better than that, pick up the Qur'an, inshallah. Pick up the Qur'an and realize that they can hold on to their faith in God. They can hold on to their hope in paradise. They can hold on to their belief in all of the prophets, including Isa alayhi salam. They don't have to throw all these great things away. They can keep that. And additionally, they get to gain the pristine example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and which is the focus of today, they get to leave that which is unsupported logically, morally, and scripturally. So I'd like to close, inshallah, by reminding all of us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي. Say, this is my way. I invite to Allah. I call people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what? With insight, upon clear evidence. With eyes wide, basira, with eyes open, with good questions and with good thinking, I and those who follow me. In other words, we need to start taking this job more seriously. This is a time of the year where you can take advantage of this this cultural phenomenon, the holidays and so forth. And it's good. Ask questions, be curious, show genuine concern and interest in what people believe. And subhanAllah, you will find that people will genuinely respond, inshallah ta'ala, and really reflect and realize, do I really subscribe to this? Isn't there something wrong here? Maybe I need to give this a second thought. That is our job. That is our job in this country. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who call to this deen, ask appropriate questions, and have a positive effect on the community around us. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. Allahumma hdina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa barik lana fi ma a'tayt, wa qina sharra ma qadayt, fa innaka taqdi wa la yuqda alayk, innahu la yadhillu man walayt, wa la ya'izzu man adayt, tabarakta rabbana wa ta'alayt, rabbana atina fi dunya hasana, wa fil akhirati hasana, wa qina azab an-nar, wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira, wa aqim الصلاة